On the 7th of December 1941, the Japanese Imperial Navy launched a surprise attack against the United States Naval Base at Pearl Harbor, Hawaii. The attack was intended as a preventative action in order to keep the US Pacific Fleet from interfering with military actions that the Empire of Japan was planning in Southeast Asia, and this was against overseas territories of the United Kingdom, the Netherlands, and the United States. The Japanese rapidly advanced through Singapore, Hong Kong, the Philippines, Indonesia, and into Rabaul and Bougainville. On May the 2nd, 1942, the Japanese landed at Tulagi, the British capital of the Solomon Islands, and by July had moved to the largest island of Guadalcanal, where they commenced the building of an airport. The action was of great concern to New Zealand, and coastal defences such as this one were hastily constructed along the Napier foreshore. At the military level, a 3rd Division of the New Zealand Army was formed and trained to fight in the South Pacific. This division comprised the 35th, 36th and 37th Battalions. The 37th Battalion was commanded by Lieutenant Colonel A.H.L. Sugden. The Americans perceived the threat to Australia, New Zealand and Fiji to be real and moved to halt the Japanese advance by occupying New Caledonia and Vanuatu. Headquarters of this operation were set up in Noumea, and by the start of 1943, the New Zealand 3rd Division were encamped at Burrail to start intensive jungle training for later action in the Solomon Islands. Peter Sugden, your father was the commander of the 37th Battalion. Why were you so keen to follow his military footsteps 69 years on?
Well, my father was a humble man. Like many returned servicemen, he didn't talk much about the war. But he did write a chronicle on the 37th Battalion when he retired, and the 37th Battalion and its part in the 3rd Division's campaign in the Solomon Islands. On reading this, I became fascinated with the history of the 37th Battalion, especially their campaign in the Vella Lavella. It wasn't until Bob McCaw, a return to Taradale, from working in the South Pacific, that I had the expertise to get there. Through his contacts, expertise and encouragement, we were able to plan and undertake this venture.
Peter, how did the campaign of the 37th fit into the Battle of Guadalcanal?
Well, the Battle of Guadalcanal raged for 6 months from August 1942, when the United States Marines landed on Red Beach, till February 1943, when after capturing the airfield, they forced the Japanese to withdraw. After the Americans gained control, the Japanese moved north to Rabaul and Papua New Guinea. However, in so doing, they left pockets of soldiers on a number of islands to the north, Vella Lavella being one and Green Island being another. And clearing the island of Vella Lavella, especially, and Green Island, of the Japanese was assigned to the 35th and 37th Battalions. While this battle was raging, my father's New Zealand Battalion was training in amphibious landings and jungle warfare in Fiji and New Caledonia. In August 1943, the battalion in convoy landed at Point Cruz and prepared themselves for the future offensive to clear the Japanese off the island of Vella Lavella.
When you started on this pilgrimage, where did your path intersect your father's path?
Our paths crossed, Warren, when I finally arrived on the beach at Point Cruz and actually felt the sand between my toes and on at Point Cruz in Honiara on Guadalcanal.
Amazing.
Well, here I am, some 69 years ago. My father entered Point Cruz where just after he spent 18 months in Noumea, Fiji and New Caledonia, training in amphibious landings and jungle warfare before he brought his battalion here. It's a great feel to be standing right here to think this is exactly where the battalion landed Having left Noumea with the battalion in the convoy on the 24th, they were under continuous attack as they came through these narrow straits. We've got Florida Island out here, we've got Tulagi out here, and the whole area now is called Iron Bottom Sound. When the boats arrived in here, they had a competition as to see which boat could be unloaded the fastest. Transport officers offered the crew a prize to disembark, get all their equipment off, and so the boats could get back out into sea before there was any more heavy attacks from the air. When the battalion arrived on the 27th of August, they then marched after unloading. They then marched 3 miles up the coast here to Cookumburna, a beachhead there where they dug in and spent time getting ready for their advance north to Vella Lavella.
Peter, Bob and Paul visited the village as part of a World War II tour and met Leonard, a village tour guide, and Joseph, an elderly villager who had clear recollections of the time the village was occupied by both combatants.
Leonard has brought us to this spot where the 37th Battalion marched 3 miles from Point Cruz up the coast here to this spot here where they established themselves prior to moving north to Vella. They spent 23 days here, and while they were here there was continual bombarding by the Japanese Air Force, who would go overhead. There were small pockets of resistance even in 1943 of Japanese, but most of the Japanese had been driven off this part of the island by August 1943. And we're talking, but there were still little bits of pockets, so that the battalion, while they were dug in here, had to keep a watch on their backs. Not only the 37th Battalion, but the 35th came here too, because they both went up on a convoy to Vella Lavella, and Americans were here too at the same time.
Remnants of the American campsite after they'd defeated the Japanese. Who would have built that, Leonard, the Japanese or the Americans?
The Americans.
The Americans built
that. As water storage or water, for keeping water.
Leonard stated that when he was a young boy at the local missionary school, he clearly remembers a plaque attached to the mango tree which listed the presence of the 37th Battalion as one of the units that camped in the village in 1943.
I remember quite very well. The Japanese came in earlier, so much earlier that they started building this airstrip. And of course, they keep on moving westernward, like sort of like coming down, checking all these areas. And then I remember very well that they came into the village, Japanese came into the villages and killing chooks, pigs, whatever they see on in the villages. And yeah, the women and the children went to the hills. And of course, the bigger boys or the men, Japanese use them as laborers.
Laborers.
To carry
did coconut
plants.
Did they use you?
No, he's smaller than
that. He was too small.
Battalion left here with their LCPs, which are the landing craft personnel, the landing craft tanks with the lumbering vessels, and the landing craft infantry. 23 vessels altogether with the destroyer escort headed off into Vella Lavella and off to land at Maribari. And that is where we're going to go.
What can you see?
Peter and his party took a flight with Solomon Airlines to Gizo. This took 1.5 hours. Back on September the 17th, 1943, his father's convoy took 27 hours to make the trip from Kokumbona, Honiara, to Marawari. On the way, they witnessed fireworks of bombing on the airfield at Munda, which had great strategic value to the Americans. Built initially by the Japanese using coral and gravel, the airfield was captured by the Americans on August the 15th, 1943. The airfield remained a target of furious attacks by the Japanese, operating out of Rabaul in Papua New Guinea. This was what the 37th witnessed in the early morning of the 18th of September, as they slid quietly, undetected, towards Vella Lavella.
This is the airstrip the Americans were building when the air boarding battalion, the convoy, came up through the sea to Vella Lavella.
At 2 a.m. on the 18th of September, the calm was broken by the alarm bells, indicating a condition red. They were passing Munda, which was enduring a raid. Bomb flashes could be seen, and the sky in the distance was live with tracer AA bursts. The speed of the convoy was slowed down, so there was no wake, which could be spotted from the air. It was a job of the convoy commander to get the battalion safely to Vella unseen.
There to meet them at the airport was Kuve, who was to provide accommodation at his small eco resort called Jitsavanga on the other side of Gizo Island. There too was their guide, Lovo, and boat skipper, Joseph. These two would be touring companions for the next 4 days. A quick stop at Gizo town was required to fill up the tanks with petrol. Stop at Gizo town was required to fill up the tanks with petrol and purchase 4 days of provisions. Then it was a beautiful evening cruise to Kuve's resort accommodation. The return to Vella Lavella was now very close and the island was clearly visible on the horizon.